Well, hello again. This is Franz Cantor, cartoonist, illustrator, and toon talker. And I'm here with
Jim Bridges, and I'm the president of the Australian Cartoon Museum. And today we're doing
The Silver Age of the Comic Book Art by Alan Schumer.
Yes, and he's a cartoonist as well. And the publisher?
The publisher is, good point, College, I don't know.
It might be self-published.
Collectors Press, Portland,
yes.
Oregon.
Yeah.
Printed in Singapore.
And it's written and designed, and you'll see why I emphasise the design, because it's a beautifully designed book. It's a feast for the eyes. It's the metal background.
Yeah, there's a lot of metal here and a lot of Photoshop filters.
Yes, a lot of Photoshop. So, and it starts off with an introduction of the 60s, because that's when the silver era was, and all the main features, they're going, you know, they're accentuating the comic
The halftone.
Yeah, but then they're also re-cleaning up lots of other pieces.
Yeah.
This is the age of
So this
of
is
Spider-Man.
His dissertation of the era.
Yeah.
His
And he has little things
essay.
Like the mentoring between the Ancient One and Ben
Dr.
Casey
Strange,
and
Ben
Dr.
Casey
Zorba.
And... Yeah, Dr. Yeah. Zorba. That's not Dr. Zorba.
Oh, sorry.
Dr. Zorba's from Planet of the Apes.
Yeah, Ben Casey and what's it?
Well, the actor.
Yeah, Dr.
Al
Zorba.
Jaffe.
Dr. Zorba.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
And of course, this is all the different uses that Dr. Strange was used. It's psychedelic things.
Yep.
Posters for rock concerts.
Yep.
And you know, the Beatles and the Fantastic Four.
Yep, with Photoshop shadow.
Yeah, who was the best Fantastic Four? Was it the Beatles or the... Yeah, and 12 cents. That's how much they cost, and they're all the characters.
Not by the time it got
Rolling,
to Australia. It was
Rolling,
about 60
yes,
cents.
I know. Rolling Stone, got Thor on the cover. There's Black Panther.
Yeah, the Hulk.
Yep. And it was
Joe
the
Cubitt.
It was the anti-war... Vietnam thing, so
yeah, Sergeant
stop
Rock.
The war. I want to get out.
Yeah, never read Sergeant Rock.
Oh,
very
great.
Interesting.
Great. And you know, you not only saw these superheroes as superheroes, you saw them as human beings.
Except they didn't have any eyes.
Yeah, and here is some
eyes.
He's hit on the head with a can of beans.
Yeah.
Yeah. And some of them tried to reflect politics.
Yep. This is a very powerful illustrative technique of combining the an image inside the silhouette of two of the characters.
So it starts with the main artist of the period, and the first one was Carmen Infantino.
Yep.
Who is famous for, I grew up with The Flash.
Yep.
All those wonderful drawings of showing movement.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Strobing.
Yes.
A lot of strobing. You can imagine this is in perspective, this run, so he'd have to draw this figure, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times. This is pre-Photoshop.
Yes.
So there's no cut and paste here. You know, left leg, right leg, left leg, right leg. He'd have to do this. It's quite a task, actually.
Yeah.
It's like drawing a panel with 8 figures in it.
He did have the characters.
Yeah. So, beautiful poses. You know, I mean, characters that are out of the 1950s sci-fi that have these beautiful balanced contrapposta poses and these dynamic vertical diagonals.
Do you want to explain what contrapposta means for the run?
Contrapposta is a balancing when you do in life drawing or sculpture or something. You know, in painting, you have a figure that's that has opposing angles, the collarbones to the hips, so it gives the figure a contrary balance, sort of like the weight thrown on the left leg is balanced by the upper torso tilting in the opposite direction.
This is from the Invasion of the Indian Giants, and here this giant Indian ripped up a tree.
Yeah.
Really mixing up the metaphors. And there was a lot of vertical panels in the 60s, a lot.
Well, they're exploring. They're trying to... I mean, the regularity of panels in the 40s, you know, and 50s...
I thought it was to get out of drawing.
Well, their storytelling improved. So the readability of the comics and the actual stories themselves, and also the writing and the grammar improved in the 60s.
Yes. Batman.
Yeah.
And, of course, the 60s is when the television show came out, yeah?
Yep.
And there's how he drew the elongated man, which is really distinct from everybody else. He sort of hasn't got that rubbery effect so much, has he? It's just like...
I don't know the history of elongated man. I know Plastic Man and all of that, but this is another...
And the writer and designer of this book has done a great job with the colouring and bringing out all the 3D effects, like in that page. It's very 3D. Basic stuff for Batman compared to the stuff that came later in the 60s.
Yeah, but there is some...
very solid.
Yeah, there's... I mean, Batman...
Statuesque.
See, the thing about Batman covers is that they, in this era, they had a lot of variety.
Yeah.
So you have, like, elements of horror, you know, elements of, you know, adventure.
But this is the classic Greek hero in those poses, whereas later on, you know... there's Mr. Freeze.
Yep.
And Boomerang. God, he looks like a weird flight attendant, doesn't he?
Yeah.
And this is Dead Man. Yeah. Very interesting character who is not quite dead.
Tutu Girl.
Yeah, and he has to... He gets into the bodies of people.
Awesome.
Yeah. Steve Ditko, fantastic.
This is typical of Steve Ditko showing the inner and the outer of the character.
Yeah.
And so you can see that he's peeling away.
And he used the face a lot in all his work.
Very powerful storytelling elements for Ditko. You can see with the expressions of horror.
Yeah.
So these were, I mean, the author is referencing, you know, early Twilight Zone.
Yeah. So this is a lot of the... this is a Bob Kane face.
Supernatural.
Bob Kane face from early Superman. And he's a comic historian, and so he's sort of talking about influences.
Yeah.
And here is Spider-Man.
Hmm.
That classic. That's a lovely image, isn't it? It's like the Batman image in the sky.
Yeah. This is early Spider-Man, of course, with the webbing.
Yeah. Coming straight at you.
Yep. So some of the characters I would have followed, you know, Electro, Sandman, not so much Green Goblin.
Great layout with what he's done here.
Yeah, I can't remember this guy.
No. But I wouldn't punch him in the face, it might shatter.
Yeah.
And here he is, Doctor Strange.
Yeah.
He's our favourite.
Master of the Mystic Arts.
This is how Doctor Strange starts off, a rootless character just flopping around, then something happens to him, he becomes an urbane, sophisticated dabber in the black.
Well, he has these powers. These are Ditko...
look at those hands.
You know, magical fingers.
Yeah. That references...
This is Doctor Strange's mansion.
Yeah.
So at the top of Doctor Strange's mansion, he has this iconic window.
Yeah.
Which is... I think they tried to get this effect with the crow.
The film?
Yeah, with the film.
Well, and they talk about this is influenced by the spirit and also the Doctor No film.
Mm.
Anyway, so this is what he does, the writer... And, you know...
So that's handy, isn't it? He's referencing all of these things that you can then go and check.
Yeah, like a historian, but he's a visual historian.
Yeah.
So it's a great book. And here is the reality of the unreal world of...
So there's every kind of shape imaginable that you can, you know... I mean, these are representative of neurons exploding, electrical impulses and other things, shapes inside the brain itself. So
trees, which are actually made of rock and
yeah.
solidified, all sorts of techniques.
Yeah.
And then the Spider-Man character, which that's a great cover. That's a great comic too.
Yeah. Well, these are both iconic covers.
Yes. Yes.
This is Eternity.
Yes.
This is a double up, in not crossover in stories, but two yeah. separate stories. You know, Nick Fury, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. and Doctor Strange. this is an iconic cover of Spider-Man, where he wants to pack it in.
Yeah,
Blue Beetle.
Yeah, Creeper. Different characters.
Yeah.
Different companies.
Different companies,
Hawk and Dove.
Yep. Yeah.
And the Question.
That's, yeah, the yeah. Question.
And look how this face is in, you know, the back of that. You can't see the eyes or anything. It's just sort of the face within the face. It just does these wonderful things with the face. The symbolism is the...
Yeah,
yeah, the
Mr.
Question.
A.
Yeah. And now we have Jack Kirby. Probably the most powerful artist of the 60s who had so much influence because he had so much output as well.
Yeah, and a lot of imagination.
Yeah.
So he could actually do, you know, these tight, strange fights and, you know, also get involved in things that are not, like, half seen and, you know, Invisible Woman just fading, but she's fading in parts.
Gil Kane said the first 100 issues of the Fantastic Four was the best... the best use of storytelling and all aspects of cartooning comics that have ever been done, and he doesn't think it'll ever be achieved. Here's Doctor Doom.
Well, he uses the covers are very punchy. The covers, there's no question about it. They're totally different to other comic covers.
And they're 3D. They're 3D.
They're very 3D. They use a lot of very powerful graphic design.
Yeah. A lot of scale.
Yeah. Yeah, you can see the scale.
A lot of scale.
Yeah, scale again. You know, so the metaphor of this, you know, playing chess, whereas this doesn't actually happen this way in the comic.
That's the puppet
gives
master
you the,
sort of idea,
yeah,
isn't it?
Exactly.
You know? And Jack Kirby identified with this character.
Yeah, the thing.
And he'd drawn him years ago in another
More blobby.
Yeah.
And then became more and more highly stylized.
Yeah, and he...
Into this really fun
he's
character.
He's famous for saying it's clobbering time.
Yeah.
And this
and talking is, about Yancey Street Boys.
Yeah, and here's Kirby as the Thing, Ben Grimm, drawing another character. And
yeah.
the Photoshop has brought all these guys, all these characters are Kirby's. All these characters are Kirby's. Nick Fury is based on his war hero, his wartime.
So they really leapt off the page, and you know when you're comparing it to other comics, Marvel comics at this time, his Captain America covers and other, you know, what else did you? Fantastic Four, for example, you know, a comic book with a Fantastic Four cover done by Kirby,
yeah,
next to Superman or Batman, there's no competition.
And he had this epic style for Thor comics.
Well, in keeping with the idea of Asgard and the you know the idea this is a physical god that's brought to Earth, that's come to Earth to save us. It's a very Jewish concept of the Messiah and all of this sort of stuff.
Yeah.
You know, but
there's an early version. That's a Kirby of Thor here, done in the 40s.
So his
42.
His take on anatomy is based on action. It's based on this sort of sinewy graphic, this sinewy design.
He invented
and things coming at the camera, things going away from the camera.
He invented muscles that don't exist.
Exactly. Yeah. So they're more stylized, but they're stylized within the Kirby.
Yes.
Visual vocabulary.
Yes, I like what you're saying. That's
yeah.
Well. There's so always this 3D effect. Always.
Exactly. So he would do, for example, right? You've got the character jumping at the camera. Now this would work whether it be a female character or a male character. You can see the legs are astride. They're akimbo, right? So the character's very. It's not sexualized. What's the word? It's very.
Neutralized?
No. It's kind of like It's just dynamic. Yeah, it's
dynamic. It's just dynamic.
But usually, if you were to draw a female character with the legs, apart like this in an action pose, which he's done before, it's not sexual.
No.
It's dynamic.
Yeah, it's dynamic.
It's at the mercy of the design of the. Of the creator of Kirby.
The panel before that
to
one.
To tell a story visually.
The panel
exciting.
Before that one has all these guys completely covering Captain America, and then he goes pow, and they all shoot off in the opposite direction.
Yeah. So there's
And this is the dynamic. Here he's punching two people at once.
Well, this is Batroc. Yeah. Batroc is a French. He's very acrobatic. So
yes.
Both Captain America and Batroc have this sort of physical ballet
in the air.
And in
some cases you see actually both fists are punching someone at the same time and both feet are kicking. So he's attacking four
people at once. If you were to have a fight in a comic, you'd be hard pressed to find anything better than Captain America and Batroc or Captain America and
that was a great issue. Yeah. That was a great issue. And of course Kirby went into collage.
Yeah, one of the first explorations into
collage,
exploring the idea of a different realm again in a different way than Ditko.
Yeah,
totally different.
And there's this epic,
beautiful. Yeah. So it doesn't matter what size the panel or what size the page or anything.
Yeah.
You know, Kirby will fill it with absolute
look at this
ease.
Look at this drawing of the anatomy. It's just.
But not only that,
it's 3D, but you've never seen the
look
body.
Look where the hand is. Yeah. The hand is paddling. It's in paddling pose.
Right, coming up close to you. But the drawing is like you've never seen a body in that shape before. You've never seen a. He did that a lot.
Mm.
And of course, he had smashing up stuff and.
So he'd think of things. He'd problem solve.
Yes.
These action scenes. He would problem solve the action scenes. He was a physical man. He used to fight as well. He was in the war.
Yeah.
So he knew a lot about physical action. And he also loved, the details and the elements that he'd put in of machinery.
That's the Yancey Street. That's where he grew up.
Yeah.
And that's all that detail about. He's trying to get the whole atmosphere, the sound and everything with the clothes hanging across the slums, the policemen, the kids. Fighting, pinching
That's
things.
That's a great shot.
Yeah. It's an early pencil.
Yep.
And of course, he invented things. He invented machinery and spaceships like nobody before him.
Things that you couldn't create.
Yeah.
I tried to make a lot of the machinery that he designed because my father was a carpenter. So I had absolutely no chance of creating anything.
And Fantastic Four, he was the first artist to draw him, and it's just beautiful. Look at all the drawing of him flying over New York.
Yeah, so Chrome, he's Chrome, the Silver Surf is Chrome. Yeah. And this is would problem solve the drawing of Chrome.
Yeah.
So you could see the way that he would depict the reflections of the sky and the earth.
And the Silver Surfer was the closest to Hamlet. The comics ever got. He's one of the
incredible, in the storytelling. Yes,
yeah, he's one of the incredible characters, Galactus, who actually eats universes.
Yeah,
and he is his scout.
Yep,
the Silver Surfer is his scout.
Yep,
and here's the Kirby Crackle.
Yep,
the famous Kirby Crackle.
Yep, which is like this electrical energy that has.
Yeah, look at this, the comic Pieta.
Yeah. Yeah, the Pieta, the Madonna holding the body of Jesus, the Father holding the Son.
Yeah, yep.
Look at everything is in there, the pathos, the sadness and everything. This is a cover of a comic book, folks.
Yeah.
You know, here's a cover
the hammer
of a comic
and
book
the Holocaust.
Where Thor is breaking through with his hammer, breaking through a wall right at you.
Yeah.
But these, you know, here's the God of Thunder leaping at you from Asgard down to Earth.
Yeah.
So these are comics that just, you know, sat on the comic book shelf. Not for very long, because people would see it and they'd have to buy it.
And he jumped ship, he went over to DC and started the New Gods.
The New Gods, yeah. So this is, you'll see a lot of this stuff in modern cartoons, like, Ben 10 and a lot of comic book covers. Hellboy, for example, you know, big Hellboy fan, how's that?
We will get back to Kirby in future films, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Lots to discover. Gil Kane, He's regarded as the intellectual cartoonist because he writes really well on other people's work. And he was, I would say he was influenced by 3D and Kirby as well. And he loved Kirby very much.
Gil had a perfectly constructed figures.
Yes.
So his figures had... he could draw figures at any angle. These are all from his... mostly from his imagination.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, obviously that's a very Bernd Hogarth hand there.
Yeah.
But the way that he would draw figures were...
very clean, very clean and...
and correct.
Yeah.
I was only introduced to Gil Kane in the later series. So this is a very later series of Gil Kane, this sort of style of the fingers are very elegant and elongated.
And here's the authors showing us the Kirby impact on his work.
Yeah. So...
and there's this wonderful, you know, like...
yeah, if you were to study action, Kirby.
Yeah.
There's no one substitute. Yeah, so he had a very elegant style.
Yes, very elegant. And this bloke's not elegant, but he's very powerful. Joe Kubert.
Yeah.
Started out very early in comics with this character, who looks very unusual for the
It's a hard character to do.
Yeah.
He's got this ungainly mask on.
Yeah.
This is obviously in Flash comics, so the star is Flash.
Yeah.
You think about this, it's not like, you know, Birdman or anything like that.
Birdman.
Yeah, it's quite a hard character to do.
And he came into his own, I think, with the war stuff.
Yeah, Sergeant Rock.
Yeah,
it's
wonderful
stuff. Like his,
wonderful stuff. This is the 3, everything's 3D, isn't it?
Mm.
And Enemy Ace, the unparalleled series of the Red Baron.
Yeah.
And lots of use of vertical panels, lots.
Mm.
I think he was the best at doing
it. Well, diving.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. He's really become the master storyteller
yeah.
in many ways. There's a lot of, that's a very, that's extremely strong.
Yeah.
That's very
introspective.
Kurtzman.
Yeah. Yep.
Now, Gene Colan is a master of elegant, you know...
but superheroes.
Action, elegant action.
Elegant action, yes.
Yeah. So you see here...
nicely phrased,
yeah.
Yes.
So you can see Prince Namor, the Submariner here. He uses the vibration or the swirls of the water inside and the weed. You'll see elements of this... curves in material later on.
He made Daredevil his own, the blind character.
Yeah,
beautifully, like it's just Olympics, isn't it?
Mm.
It's Olympics.
Well, there's a lot of very solid drawing there. A lot of very
wonderful
solid
shape. Wonderful shape.
Yep, perspective. This is where he kind of excelled with both Doctor Strange and the Tomb of Dracula. He was able to concentrate on the flow of energy and the, you know, the movement of the characters.
Mm.
And the characters were draped.
Mm.
So, you know,
he used
clothing and drapery, especially capes and loose-fitting material, are quite hard to draw because you need to understand
material
in
motion. He used them in the dynamic part of the story.
Part of the dynamic elements of the story,
in both the Dracula series and Doctor Strange.
Yeah.
And Jim Steranko, who came and went out of comics, he was a big influence, but he wasn't here long, was he?
No, but he was very influential. He came when Captain America was in decline.
Yeah.
Kirby just couldn't do it anymore. He was just just physically unable
but
to
he
do
was connected
all the
to the graphic period of the time.
Yeah.
And so there's this pop art.
Well, also
I mean the pop art is
Nick Fury, Agent of Shield.
Yeah.
Agent of Shield, SHIELD.
Yeah.
This was at the time the height of
Bond,
Get Smart and Man from Uncle. So there was a huge interest in spy drama.
But the pop artist, they pinched from the comics and processed it, and then he put it back into the comics through processing. You know what I mean? This is examples of his work. That's a Wallywood cover, and that's how we were sort of influenced by the early 50s, and it's a Spirit cover from the 40s, and then this is what he did.
Yeah, experimenting with psychedelics.
Yeah. And of course, this is all his action stuff, which is really, it's ballet, it's sort of opera.
Well,
it's not ballet, it's sort of opera. It's over the top, you know what I mean?
Well, it is. It's an understanding of Kirby, and also an understanding, I think, of some of the action from famous paintings, from classic paintings.
Yeah, well, you see that muscle in the leg is just as big as his, thin as his torso. It's just extraordinary. Yeah, and all the effects. Look at it.
How about this for a cover?
Yeah. You wouldn't need 3D glasses for that, would you?
No, but you see, he loved graphics and he used them quite a lot.
And he's plugging into the graphic period of the time.
Yeah.
So here he has the flag waving, whereas someone else would just have the stripes going across, and they sort of, they help the characters.
Yeah.
And of course, there's almost a caricature of an explosion.
Yeah.
Everything's contained within the actual sound of it.
Yep. This is The Death of Captain America, which was beautifully done. This is actually my favourite comic book cover.
And that's
and this is the, I think, the third page in, I think.
That's an iconic...
Well, it's a pyramid.
Yeah, but it's an iconic thing. I mean
Frazetta used to use it.
Yeah, but you could have the Greeks fighting the Spartans fighting the Persians, or you know, but it's they've got guns and stuff. It's got this ageless thing about it, and then he gets into the
Dali
surrealism, and there he is.
Yeah. So everything is not as it seems. There's some beautiful ideas in there. He was also experimenting with surrealism in painting at the same time.
Yeah, I think he burnt himself out with comics, don't you?
Possibly.
Yeah, you met him once, yeah?
Yeah.
You don't want to talk about that?
About meeting him? No.
Okay. Well, this is Neil Adams.
Tell me all about Neil Adams, because I don't know very much about him.
Well, he started off with the realistic style, and here he is. Having the whole picture of Ben Casey over three panels. He did a lot of that, and of course
and they all look like the guys.
He was the most realistic of all the cartoonists working at that stage, although he did all his extraordinary, that's one face, that's Dead Man.
Yeah.
Is it Dead Man? Yes, Dead Man. And because he could draw so well, there was a war started when I was younger between Jack Kirby style of cartooning comics and Neil Adams. And of course, a lot of people got into art through Neil Adams.
Yeah.
You know, classical art, you know. And he is his.
Well, he's very versatile.
Yeah.
So his anatomy is correct. He had the movement of Jean Collin. He had, you know, the drama of.
But to my mind, his work was too realistic. And although he did stuff like. This is some of his work. The Dead Man series in particular. Yeah, that says. Hey, another Steranko effect. And he did tricks like this, you know, like this, there's Marilyn walking through this. But at the same time, I thought it was just too realistic, whereas the classic people who do comic stories, they use caricature, they use all sorts of aspects of the comic form to tell the story. I thought he was just too realistic, but...
Well, he was using the comic...
This is interesting because it's
he was an exponent of the comic medium, and he was using every trick in the book.
Yeah, this is how he, and of course,
that's his
he pencil. Inked a lot of his own work.
Yeah,
because he didn't want it to be changed.
Yeah.
There's an unusual paneling. It's a bit dodgy, I think, but it's still unusual. He did some wonderful stuff. There's a face.
Mm.
Some people don't even see that. They just read this. And of course, he got into social realism about drug taking, about the blacks, black skins. I want to know how come, answer me, you know. And
he can't.
He can't. drug deals, bringing in the reality of the 60s. Mm. He's like a Christ-like figure who dies, the bird flies away from him, and he smashes up this plane because he's so angry about the whole thing about fighting the big man and all that sort of stuff.
Mm.
And there's a drawing he did of Marvel versus DC. There's his character keeping him apart.
Mm.
Yeah, and here is the author of the book. There
Great.
He is. That's him.
Alan Schumer.
Yeah, and you can check out his videos on the net. They're very, very good. He's a visual comic historian.
Yeah.
And he's terrific.
So how would you rate this? There he is.
Oh, I think it's a wonderful book, and it's beautifully written, and it's beautifully designed because he's recolored everything. I mean, in some of them he has the original, color, as you were saying.
So how many word balloons would you give this one?
I wouldn't pop any of them. I wouldn't pop any
so
of them.
So five word balloons.
Yeah.
Awesome. So there's something in here for everybody.
Yes.
There you go.
That's probably the best book to show the 60s that's ever been published, in my opinion, so far.
Awesome. Thanks very much, guys. I'll see you soon.